Thank you. So.
Good afternoon. So good afternoon and welcome everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Angelina Godoy and I am the director of the Human Rights Center here at the University of Washington. I'm delighted to welcome you all to this second session of our all-day conference on access to information as a human right. In addition to hearing from some of our terrific partners, both in the morning and on this panel, we also have the distinct pleasure of sharing with you some exciting news about some of our recent activities. So I'd like to ask your attention for just a few minutes to see a film that we've prepared. Great. Good afternoon.
Access to information is a basic human right.
So good afternoon and welcome everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Angelina Godoy and I am the director of the Human Rights Center here at the University of Washington. I'm delighted to welcome you all to this second session of our all-day conference on access to information as a human right. In addition to hearing from some of our terrific partners, both in the morning and on this panel, we also have the distinct pleasure of sharing with you some exciting news about some of our recent activities.
So working with our Salvadoran partners, we identified the massacre of Santa Cruz. That was an incident that happened in November 1981 as a key incident that we wanted to look into.
Access to information
better what happened, right? And to, where possible, corroborate the survivor accounts that we had heard, which raised great concern about crimes against humanity being committed. So as part of our research process, we looked into newspaper accounts from that period, what journalists were able to document. We talked to numerous survivors of the massacre, both in El Salvador and in the United States. And we sought information from the United States government, too.
Working with our Salvadoran
individuals, we identified the massacre of and units that were an incident that happened in November 1981.
In 2013, we wrote a FOIA request to look into to understand for information what happened, on Colonel Sigfrido Ochoa Perez and his alleged involvement in the Santa Cruz massacre. And so we wrote them to four different federal agencies, and the CIA
issued us a global
response saying that they could neither confirm nor deny the existence of records.
We know they have records.
We talked to numerous survivors of the massacre, both we've obtained about 15
States,
and we
CIA
saw
documents
from the United States
that include
information
pertaining
to
specific individuals.
And so therefore, our question is,
at minimum, they could have given us access to those records that have already been made public.
In 2013, we wrote a FOIA request
this many years after the conflict,
for information on Colonel Sigfrido Ochoa Perez and his alleged involvement in
the Santa Cruz massacre. Our hope was that they would share
with us
a broader set of documents. The
federal
fact that they refused to acknowledge the existence of any documents suggests that they're not
a global response saying that they could neither confirm nor deny the existence of records.
We know they have records because through our own research we've obtained about 15 CIA documents that include the information precisely that we were seeking. And so therefore our question is, at minimum, they could have given us access to those records that have already been published this many years after the conflict. With such a strong interest in seeing justice. And
thank you very much. So we are very proud to have filed a lawsuit against the Central Intelligence Agency of the United States government on Friday, and we will do our very best to keep you updated as that process unfolds. Today, however, what we're hoping to do is share with you why we think that lawsuit matters. Why did we take this action? And in what context have we taken that action? Many of you know that our Center for Human Rights has been collaborating with Salvadoran human rights defenders now for upwards of 20 years. And we are Thank you very much. So we are very proud to have filed a lawsuit against the Central Intelligence Agency of the United States government on Friday, and we will do our very best to keep you updated as that process unfolds. Today, however, what we're hoping to do is share with you why we think that lawsuit matters. Why did we take this action? And in what context have we taken that action? Many of you know that our Center for Human Rights has been collaborating with Salvadoran human rights defenders now for upwards of 3 years. And we are, and also with American human rights defenders and human rights defenders from Spain and other nations as well, all of us training our sites on questions of crimes against humanity that occurred in the context of the Salvadoran armed conflict in the 1980s and early 1990s. In the morning, we had the pleasure and honor of hearing from Kate Doyle, who talked to us about the right to truth in the Latin American context, putting in a much broader context the struggle in which we have been involved and in which her organization, the National Security Archive, has been a principal leader. Today, though, or this afternoon, though, what we're going to hear from is some of the frontline human rights defenders from El Salvador, who are going to tell us all why this struggle for access to information matters in the context of the Salvadoran struggle for justice. So I'm going to turn the microphone over now to my friend and colleague, Professor Tony Lucero. Tony is an associate professor in the Jackson School of International Studies, and he is also the director of the Latin America and Caribbean Studies program here at the University of Washington. Tony?
Thank you very much, Angelina. And thank you all for being here. Buenas tardes, bienvenidos y bienvenidas. It's really an honor to be on this table. And today we're going to be talking about very tragic events, a massacre. But more than that, we're going to be talking about survival and struggle, and struggle that continues today in many ways. I think right now, as the world is focused on, rightly so, on the crisis of many people in the Middle East and in Europe, and the crisis of migration, we're reminded that these aren't new stories, that the stories of displacement and violence have been going on too long. It's also appropriate, I think, to remember that we're on Duwamish lands now, that in many ways we're connected to stories of displacement in very profound ways. I was also struck hearing from Kate Doyle this morning about how difficult the struggle for justice and human rights can be. I was reminded of that Greek myth of Sisyphus, who was constantly pushing that boulder up that mountain. But I thought perhaps there's a more positive way to spin that story. Sisyphus was perhaps keeping that rock from falling down on other people. Sisyphus was maybe keeping that rock there as shelter for the small. And Sisyphus must have gotten really strong pushing that rock up. So in some ways, the human rights activists who join us are children of Sisyphus in a really hopeful way, and I think that they're pushing that boulder in ways that none of us would have expected, as presidents are overthrown by popular movements throughout the Americas, and the powerful have new things to worry about. So it's really an honor to be here with you all today. I would like to very quickly introduce our panelists, and the format of our discussion will be as follows. Each will speak for around 20 minutes or so, and then we'll have a chance to have a question and answer session with the distinguished members of this panel. So please keep your questions till the end. And we'll go more or less in this order. First, I'd like to welcome Mirla Carbajal, who is an attorney at the Instituto de Derechos Humanos de la Universidad Centroamericana. That's the Human Rights Institute of the Universidad Centroamericana. She is a, that is an institute that was founded, and this is important to note, by Segundo Montes, who was one of the Jesuit priests and professors who was killed in the 1989 massacre at that university's campus. That institute remains at the forefront of human rights struggles in the region today. Mirla represents the victims of the 1981 massacre in Santa Cruz, which includes the other two panelists on this panel. She's also been the director of Asociación Pro Búsqueda, which is an organization dedicated to helping families locate the truth about children who were forcefully disappeared during the armed conflict. Second, we'll hear the testimony of Maria Dina Cabrera, who is a member of the community of Santa Marta, a survivor not only of the Santa Cruz massacre of November 1981, but also a survivor of the Riolempa massacre of March 1981. And she, like Mirla, is a defender of human rights. Finally, we will hear from Philippe Bourgois, who is a professor at the University of California, Los Angeles, where he serves as professor of anthropology and psychiatry. He's the author, with Jeff Schoenberg, of Righteous Dope Fiend, a photoethnography interweaving black and white photographs with transcribed dialogue, fieldwork notes, and critical anthropological theory and analysis, as well as numerous other critically acclaimed books and articles. While conducting research for his doctoral dissertation in El Salvador in November 1981, Philippe was caught in a military invasion of the region, and he too is a survivor of the massacre of Santa Cruz. So before we start the panel, I'd like to welcome all of them to the University of Washington.
Mirla, por favor.
Tengan todos muy buenas tardes.
Good afternoon.
Agradezco la invitación del Centro de Derechos Humanos de la Universidad de Washington.
I am very grateful for the invitation of the Center for Human Rights at the University of Washington.
Y a todos los organizadores de estas actividades.
And I'm grateful to all the organizers of these activities.
Tal como escuchamos temprano por la tarde,
as we heard early this afternoon,
el acceso a la información es un derecho fundamental de todas las personas. Que debe ser garantizado por los estados,
and it must be guaranteed by the states,
y está íntimamente relacionado con el derecho fundamental a la verdad.
And it's intimately related to the fundamental right to truth,
el cual ha sido reconocido por las Naciones Unidas,
which has been recognized by the United Nations,
y tiene asignado un día, el 24 de marzo,
one day assigned to it, which is the 24th of March.
El 24 de marzo es para El Salvador una fecha no muy feliz, porque sucedió una tragedia que fue el asesinato de Monseñor Romero.
Was the day when Monseñor Romero was murdered, and it's not a happy day in El Salvador.
Y consideramos que en su honor ha sido declarado como el día del derecho a la verdad.
And in his honor, that day was declared the day of truth.
Como ustedes conocen, durante la década de los años 70 y de los años 80 en El Salvador,
as you all know, during the decades of the 80s and the 70s in El Salvador,
sucedió un conflicto armado causado por la exclusión social de un alto porcentaje de la población.
We had an armed conflict which was caused by the social exclusion of a high percentage of the population,
que significaba una desigualdad distribución de la tierra,
which was caused by inequalities in the distribution of land,
y la acumulación de capital en pocas manos.
And also the accumulation of capital in a very few hands,
dejando al resto de la población sin acceso a los servicios básicos,
leaving the rest of the population without access to basic services,
como salud, educación, vivienda, entre otros,
such as health, education, and housing, among others.
Durante este conflicto hubo cientos de masacres, miles de desaparecidos y miles de torturados.
Hundreds of massacres, thousands of people that were tortured and disappeared.
Todos población civil.
All of them were civilian population.
Dichas violaciones en un alto porcentaje fueron atribuidas al ejército y cuerpos paramilitares que funcionaban en mi país.
And those violations in a great percentage were attributed to the army and paramilitary groups in my country.
Todos estos hechos, como ustedes también conocen, fueron financiados por el gobierno de los Estados Unidos.
All these things, as you well know, have also been financed by the government of the United States.
Pues respondían a una política del Estado.
Because they answered to some state policies.
Y con el apoyo de los órganos de inteligencia en los Estados Unidos.
Support of all the intelligence organizations in the United States.
Como el Departamento de Estado y la CIA.
Such as the CIA and the Department of State.
Todo lo que sucedía en El Salvador, como los operativos conocidos como tierra arrasada,
all of the things that were happening in El Salvador, such as the operation known as devastated land and operation cleansing,
significaba eliminar a todo ser viviente en la zona del conflicto,
meant to eliminate every living being in the area of the conflict,
sin importar que fuera un niño, una mujer o un anciano.
And it didn't matter if the person was a child, a woman, or an elderly person.
Los años en que sucedieron la mayoría de estas masacres de población civil,
the years in which the majority of the massacres of civilian population happened,
sucedieron durante los años de 1981, 1982 y 1983.
Happened during the years of 1981, 1982 and 1983.
Como la masacre de Santa Cruz en Santa Marta,
as the massacre of Santa Cruz in Santa Marta,
la masacre del Mozote en el Morazán,
the massacre of Mozote in the area of Morazán,
la masacre del Zumpul en Chalatenango,
the massacre of Chumpul en Chalatenango,
la masacre del Calabozo y de San Francisco Angulo en San Vicente,
the massacre of Calabozo en San Francisco Angulo en San Vicente,
y muchas otras masacres que me llevaría un buen tiempo mencionar.
And many other massacres that would take me a long time to mention.
Si hablamos sobre el derecho a la verdad en mi país,
if we talk about the right to truth in my country,
puedo decir que al menos en materia, en, de manera formal,
I can say that at least formally,
ha sido reconocido como un derecho por la Sala de lo Constitucional de la Corte Suprema de Justicia.
Has been recognized at least as a right by the Constitutional Court within the Supreme Court of Justice.
Que en el año 2014, en un proceso relacionado a la masacre de San Francisco Angulo,
that in the year 2014, during a process that was related to the massacre of San Francisco Angulo,
en el departamento de San Vicente, en el que fueron ejecutados población civil, en su mayoría mujeres,
in the department of San Vicente, where there was executions of civilian population, in the great majority women,
reconoció que las víctimas de graves violaciones a derechos humanos tienen derecho a conocer la verdad de lo sucedido.
It was recognized that the victims of great violations to human rights have the right to know what had happened.
Y que por lo tanto es obligación de la Fiscalía General de la República,
and therefore it's an obligation of the General Prosecutors of the Republic,
investigar los hechos,
to investigate what happened.
Es fundamental tanto para los sobrevivientes como para los defensores de derechos humanos en El Salvador.
It's fundamental for the survivors as well as the defenders of human rights in El Salvador.
Tener acceso a toda la información existente en los diferentes archivos militares o policiales.
To all the information that exists in the different archives, whether they be military or police,
tanto en El Salvador como en los Estados Unidos.
As much in El Salvador as in the United States.
El acceso a la información en El Salvador ha tenido importantes avances al haberse creado una ley de acceso a la información.
Access to information in El Salvador has had made important advances when the law of access of information was created,
que ha permitido a diferentes organizaciones de derechos humanos,
which has allowed different organizations of human rights,
solicitar al Estado Mayor Conjunto de la Fuerza Armada,
to solicit the high hierarchy of the armed forces,
y al Ministerio de la Defensa Nacional,
and to the Ministry of National Defense,
información sobre los operativos militares realizados en diferentes zonas del país.
All the information regarding the operations, the military operations that were carried out in the different areas of the country,
que incluyeron masacres, desapariciones de niños y niñas y torturas,
which included massacres, disappearance of young people, children, and also torture.
Sin embargo, los militares actualmente niegan la existencia de esos archivos.
However, at the present time, military are still denying the existence of such records,
argumentando que fueron destruidos, sin especificar cuándo, y por qué fueron destruidos.
And they allege that they have been destroyed, but they don't explain when or why they were destroyed.
Es por ello que la Corte Suprema de Justicia,
that is why the Supreme Court of Justice,
ha exigido a los militares en un proceso de exhibición personal,
has demanded that the military in a process of finding out,
por la desaparición de cinco niños y niñas en mayo de 1981,
to answer about the disappearance of children in May of 1981,
dentro del operativo conocido como Operación Limpieza,
within the frame of the operation known as Operation Cleansing,
que no basta con argumentar que los archivos no existen o que han sido destruidos.
And it's not enough to allege that the records do not exist or that they have been destroyed,
sino que es obligación de las Fuerzas Armadas,
but it's the duty of the armed forces,
explicar por qué han sido destruidos,
to explain why they have been destroyed,
y la responsabilidad institucional respecto a su destrucción.
And the institutional responsibility with respect to their destruction.
Sin embargo, poco o nada importa a los militares dar una respuesta.
However, the military care little or none about giving an answer.
Es por ello que es importante para las víctimas sobrevivientes del conflicto armado,
that is why it's so important for the surviving victims of the armed conflict,
el poder accesar a la información existente en los Estados Unidos,
to be able to access the existing information in the United States,
tanto en el Departamento de Estado como en la CIA,
so in the Department of State as well as in the CIA,
pues estamos seguros que esa información existe.
Because we're sure that information exists.
En la que se especifica que qué altos jefes militares participaron en esas graves violaciones a derechos humanos.
And we will find out that high chiefs of the military participate in the violation of human rights.
Y que incluso ahora siguen siendo protegidos.
And even right now they're being protected.
Pues se justifica que todas esas operaciones eran para eliminar a enemigos internos.
Then they justified by saying that all those operations were in order to eliminate the internal enemies.
Cuando en realidad se trataba de población civil.
When in fact they were talking about civilians.
No podemos negar que había un grupo armado en El Salvador.
We cannot deny that there was an armed group in El Salvador,
y que la población civil quedaba atrapada en esa zona de conflicto,
and that the civilian population was trapped in that area of conflict.
Pero por política eran considerados enemigos.
But as part of the politics, they were considered enemies.
Y se consideraba que era necesario quitarle el agua al pez.
And it was considered necessary to deprive the fish of water.
Lo que significaba que la población civil podría estar proveyendo a los grupos armados de agua o comida.
Which meant that the civilian population could be provided the armed group with water or food.
Incluso existía una orden,
and there was even an order,
de no dejar ningún ser vivo,
of not leaving anybody alive behind,
como sucedió en el Mozote, en que se asesinaron a niños desde 0 años.
Like it happened in El Mozote, where they murdered children who weren't even a year old yet.
La información que pudiera existir en Estados Unidos,
the information that could exist in the United States,
contribuiría al combate de la impunidad en mi país.
Would contribute to a combating impunity in my country.
Pues permitiría conocer la participación directa de militares como el coronel Sigifrido Ochoa Pérez.
Because it would allow us to know the direct participation of military people like a Colonel Sigifrido Ochoa Pérez.
Quien según los testimonios y otras investigaciones,
who, according to the testimonies and other investigation,
es responsable de lo sucedido en la masacre de Santa Cruz,
is the responsible for the massacre that happened in Santa Cruz,
ocurrida en 1981,
which happened in 1981,
y en otras masacres como la del calabozo,
and in other massacres like the one that happened in El Calabozo.
Coronel que aún en estos días,
even today, the colonel
sigue negando lo sucedido,
continues denying what happened,
argumentando que todo fue dentro del marco de una guerra.
And he alleges that everything happened within the framework of a war.
Por eso creemos que el gobierno de Estados Unidos no debe seguir protegiendo a estos militares.
That's why we believe that the government of the United States should not continue protecting these military people.
Pues con ello se violenta el derecho a la verdad de las víctimas.
Because in doing so they are violating the right to truth that the victims have.
Y de todos los ciudadanos.
And that all the citizens have.
Pues no se contribuye a la democracia que se pretende fortalecer.
Because we're not contributing with that to the democracy that we are trying to strengthen.
Ya que si los crímenes de lesa humanidad que sucedieron en el pasado siguen impunes,
because if we continue to allow impunity for the crimes against humanity that have happened in the past,
se envía un mal mensaje a todos los que cometen violaciones a derechos humanos.
We're sending the bad message to all the people who are committing violations to human rights.
Deben los estados reconocer,
the states must recognize,
que para las víctimas de graves violaciones a derechos humanos,
that for the victims of serious violations of human rights,
conocer la verdad es parte de la reparación.
To know the truth is part of the recovery.
Por todo lo que ha sucedido.
For everything that has happened.
En mi país, ningún militar ha sido juzgado por estas graves violaciones a derechos humanos.
In my country, none of the military have been brought to justice because of their violation of human rights.
Y siguen estando seguros que la justicia no les tocará.
And they continue to be sure that justice will not reach them.
Y cuando nos damos cuenta que instituciones como la CIA niega esta información,
and we realize that institutions such as the CIA denies this information,
vemos menos seguridad que la justicia llegue a mi país.
We are less hopeful that justice will reach our country.
Y que la impunidad siga reinando.
And that we feel that impunity will continue to reign.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mirla. We now turn the microphone over to Dina Cabrera.
Tengan todas y,
está bien.
Y todos muy buenas tardes y gracias por la invitación, gracias por estar aquí este día compartiendo.
Good afternoon all of you and thank you for the invitation and thank you for your attendance and being here sharing this with us.
Gracias a la Universidad de Washington y a los organizadores de este evento.
We are thankful to the University of Washington and the organizers of this event.
Voy a contar una parte de mi historia porque es muy larga y el tiempo no es bastante. Pero
I'm going to tell you a part of my story because it's a very long story and I don't have that much time.
En mi comunidad Santa Marta, nosotros antes vivíamos, nosotros decíamos que felices, pero viéndolo bien, no éramos felices porque no teníamos tierra donde trabajar la mayoría de habitantes.
In my community in Santa Marta, we were living, well, we could say we were happy, but in reality we weren't happy because we didn't have land to till and to work. The majority of the people there didn't have it.
Eran poquitos los dueños de las tierras.
The people who owned the land were very few people.
Nosotros pagábamos como agricultores un porcentaje muy grande.
As people who till the land in agriculture, we paid a very high percentage.
Del trabajo cultivado era más para el terrateniente que para nosotros.
And from whatever we grew, the profit of it went in a larger amount to the landowner than to us.
Por eso decidimos organizarlo para un mejor futuro para nuestras familias.
So we decided to get organized to get a better life in the future for our family.
Pero no pensamos de que esa organización los iba a traer muchas muertes y muchas desapariciones de familiares.
But we never thought that act of getting organized would bring us so much death and so many disappearance of relatives.
Como el masacre concluido primero en el río Lempa el 18 de marzo de 1981.
Like the massacre that happened on the Lempa River on the 18th of March of 1981.
Donde murieron muchos compañeros asesinados por las bombas que tiraban los aviones.
Where many friends and relatives died and murdered by the bombs that were being thrown from the planes.
Los ametrallamientos del ejército por tierra.
The machine guns of the army on land.
Y mucha gente en la desesperación que se tiró al río y se ahogaron.
And many people in desperation threw themselves in the river and they drowned.
Y no fueron encontrados tampoco ni en el río.
And they were never even found in the river.
Luego a los 9 meses, contarles también de que para ese masacre del río Lempa.
I also want to tell you that massacre on the Lempa River.
Yo tenía un niño de 3 días de nacido.
And that time I had a newborn baby. He was only 3 days old.
Había nacido en el monte, huyendo del ejército.
He was born during the flight from the army in the middle of the woods.
Luego del masacre en el río Lempa, fue intoxicado con las bombas lacrimógenas.
And after the massacre in the Lempa River, he became toxic with all of the tear gases that were thrown.
Y murió.
And he died.
Y luego a los 9 meses, tuvimos el otro masacre en Santa Cruz.
And then 9 months later, we have the other massacre in Santa Cruz.
Donde fuimos llamados a concentrarlos en un lugar que se llama Peña Blanca.
We were called to gather in a place called Peña Blanca.
Donde no sabíamos para dónde los llevaban y qué los iba a suceder en el camino.
And we didn't know where they were taking us or what was going to happen along the way.
Como a las 11 a 12 de la noche emprendimos el viaje.
We started the trip about 11 or 12 at night.
Algunos no, sin retorno porque no volvimos a verlos.
And some of them never returned from that trip because we never saw them again.
Donde fue el suceso más desastroso que fue donde murió muchísima gente.
It was the most disastrous thing that ever happened because a lot of people died at that time.
Donde los encontrábamos con niños gritándole a sus padres que los habían perdido y algunos otros estaban asesinados.
And we were running to children who were screaming for their parents because they had become separated from them and thought they had been abandoned, but the parents had been murdered.
Y donde encontrábamos a muchos compañeros cortados de sus piernas.
And we found many people we knew and lived around our area who had had their legs cut off.
Algunos otros con las tripas de fuera.
Some other people had their guts outside the body.
Pidiendo los auxilios a los que pasábamos por encima de ellos que los recogiéramos, que no los dejáramos perdidos, que los lleváramos donde nosotros íbamos.
And they were asking for help to those of all who were walking on top of them, and they asked to please don't abandon them and take them with us wherever we were going.
Yo deseaba cargarlos.
I wanted to pick them up and take them.
Pero no podía porque yo estaba embarazada de 4 meses y herida de bala también.
But I couldn't do that because I was 4 months pregnant and I also had a bullet wound.
Y otros niños gritaban pidiéndolos comida.
And other children were screaming, asking for food.
Preguntándolos por su mamá, por su papá, que dónde estaban.
Asking, where is my mother, where is my father?
Y nosotros no sabíamos de ellos.
And we didn't know anything about them.
Fue una desesperación muy grande.
It was a time of great desperation.
Ya en la madrugada pensando qué iba a suceder al amanecer.
And it was close to dawn and we were thinking, what is going to happen when the day begins?
Porque sabíamos que al amanecer iban a ser los aviones los que iban a masacrar más al pueblo.
Because we knew that in daylight the planes were coming and they were going to massacre the people.
Porque ya el ejército salvadoreño ya lo había agarrado las consignas con que nosotros los identificábamos.
And the Salvadoran army had already found out what were the passwords that we used to identify each other.
Así fue como los equivocamos cuando los llamaban a nosotros y no nosotros pensábamos que eran los mismos compañeros que los llamaban.
And so we made a mistake, and when they were calling us, we thought that they were those who were with us that were calling us.
Y era a las manos de los soldados que nosotros llegábamos.
And we would end up in the hands of the soldiers.
Fue un lamento muy, muy grande porque encontrábamos muchas personas desesperadas, como que andaban locas, trastornadas de la...
It was a horrible time because we ran into a lot of people that were going crazy. They had lost their sanity.
Y no hallábamos para dónde salir porque salíamos para un lado, estaba el ejército.
And we didn't know in which direction we should go because if we went in this direction, we ran into the army.
Luego salimos de allí para unos montes.
So we went out of there and we got into the thicket.
Había unas cuevas que le decíamos nosotros donde los refugiábamos también.
And there were some caves where we used to take refuge in.
Donde no teníamos ni qué comer ni agua para tomar.
And in there we didn't have anything to eat and we didn't have any water to drink.
Yo pasé 16 días sin comer nada.
I went through 16 days without eating anything.
Luego me encontré con un señor, con su esposa y sus 3 hijos.
Then I ran into a gentleman with his wife and his 3 children.
Y él los iba a traer agua en sus botas que andaba en sus pies.
And he was barefooted because he would go and fetch some water and bring it back in his boots.
Porque donde había agua estaba lejos y para que nosotros tomáramos.
But he had to go a long way in order to get that water because it was far away and he would bring it for us to drink.
Lamentablemente el señor tuvo un accidente por ir huyendo.
Unfortunately, because he was fleeing, he had an accident.
A los militares que estaban viéndolo donde salía la gente para asesinarlo subido en los palos.
And the military were watching to see where people were running to, climbing on trees in order to get away.
Y el señor por ir huyendo se cayó en un río.
And since he was running from them, he fell into the river.
Con sus 2 hijos.
With his 2 children.
Uno se partió la cabeza, aquí, la niña.
The little girl burst her head in two.
Luego el niño se partió más abajo aquí en la frente.
But the boy just got a cut here in the forehead.
La niña no volvió a hablar.
The little girl never spoke again.
Ni a llorar.
She never cried again.
Y se llenó de gusanos.
And she was full of worms.
Y también el niño también.
And also the boy.
El papá se golpeó mucho, se voló pedazos de los dedos.
The father lost pieces of his fingers.
De los codos y de la espalda.
And he was hurting his back and his elbows.
Quedó como quien le agarran así los pellejos y le pasaban un cuchillo colgando del golpe.
And some of the flesh was hanging as if somebody had cut him up with a knife and left the flesh out.
La niña murió a los 11 días después del accidente.
After the accident, little girl died 11 days later.
Luego encontrábamos padres y madres preguntando que si habíamos visto a sus hijos.
Then we ran into mothers and fathers who were asking, have you seen my children?
y aún todavía no se han encontrado, algunos siguen buscándolos a través de los de ProBúsqueda.
And some people are still searching for their children through ProBúsqueda.
Y no se saben si viven o si ellos murieron.
And they don't know if they're still alive or if they died.
Es una tristeza muy grande que todavía hay en Santa Marta.
There is a great sadness that remains in Santa Marta.
Porque hay personas y familias que perdieron familias en la masacre de Río Lempi y en la masacre de Santa Cruz.
Because there are families who lost their relatives both in the massacre of Lempa River and in Santa Cruz.
Y ahora son unos ancianos y necesitan el apoyo de sus seres que ya no están con ellos.
And now they're elderly and they need the support of those people who are no longer with them.
Y nosotros queremos que haya justicia.
And we want to see justice being done.
Porque esas víctimas no pueden quedar en la impunidad.
Because those victims could not remain with the impunity.
Que aún todavía se ríe Ochoa Pérez.
Ochoa Pérez still laughing.
Y dice que él no se acuerda que hubieron masacres en Santa Cruz.
And he says he doesn't remember that there ever was any massacre in Santa Cruz.
Y dice de que él es inocente de todo lo que se le acusa.
And he says he's innocent of everything he's been accused of.
Y nosotros lo que queremos es una investigación que llegue a profundidad.
And we want an investigation in depth.
Y que pague por esos crímenes cometidos.
And we want him to pay for the crimes he committed.
Y muchos más personas del ejército que todavía se siguen riendo.
And many more people in the army who are still laughing.
Contando las barbaries que hicieron ese noviembre del 81.
Recounted the atrocities that were committed in that November of 81 by them.
Entonces por eso nosotros estamos ahora aquí gracias a personas como ustedes, como Angelina, como los demás compañeros que se encuentran aquí, que también son partícipes de nosotros, de querer.
So we are here thanks to you, thanks to people like Angelina and the other people that are here who are part of us and who also want to do this.
De poder encontrar esos archivos que incrimine.
To find those records that incriminate.
Al coronel Cifrido Ochoa Pérez como actor intelectual de esos masacres.
To help us prove that Colonel Cifrido Ochoa was the intellectual author of the massacre.
Porque todavía en Santa Marta hay gente sin sus miembros de su cuerpo.
And there are people still in Santa Marta who have lost limbs.
Gracias a esos operativos que él comandó en ese entonces.
Thanks to the operation that he commanded at that time.
Por eso nosotros queremos justicia.
That's why we want justice.
Y esperamos en las ayudas de las organizaciones no gubernamentales que nos están apoyando.
And we, our hope is in the non-governmental agencies that are helping us.
A los derechos humanos.
Human rights.
Que algún día vamos a ver una luz en el camino.
And we hope someday we'll see some light along our path.
Y que el Señor va a pagar por todo lo que ha hecho.
And that gentleman is going to pay for everything he has done.
Porque no se puede quedar esos crímenes en impunidad.
Because those crimes cannot stay in impunity.
Porque hay un dolor todavía muy grande en nuestra comunidad Santa Marta.
Because the community of Santa Marta still bears a very great pain about it.
Entonces, era bien doloroso en ese momento porque habían muchachas embarazadas que iban, estuvimos en ese, concentrados en ese lugar.
It was a very painful time. There were a lot of women that were pregnant and we were all gathered together at that time.
Desesperados, sin saber qué futuro llevábamos esa noche.
And we were desperate. We didn't know what life held for us that night.
El día siguiente en la tarde,
in the afternoon of the following day,
yo estaba enfrente donde fue el masacre.
I was right in front of where the massacre was.
Yo miraba un humo negro que salía ya en la tarde el siguiente día.
In the afternoon of the following day, I could see black smoke coming out of there.
Luego se iba un olor como a carne asada.
And then I perceived a smell like roasting meat.
Y era la población que estaban quemando.
And it was the population that was being burned.
Donde quemaron gente herida y al voto ya estaban muertos.
They burned people who were dead, but they also burned people who were wounded.
Por eso nosotros no los conformamos todavía.
That's why we are not content yet.
Durante no llegue la justicia a esas personas que lo merecen.
And we won't be until justice is being done on those people who deserve it.
Es bien duro todavía recordar.
It's still very hard to remember.
Todavía recuerdo las preguntas que los niños que encontraba me hacían.
I still remember the questions of the children I ran into.
Preguntando si le había visto a sus padres y yo ni los conocía.
They were asking me if I had seen their parents and I didn't even know them.
Y los compañeros que estaban heridos pidiendo auxilio.
And of our people that were wounded who also wanted us to give them some help.
Mi mamá quedó con 9 hijos cuando asesinaron a mi papá.
My mother was left with 9 children when my father was murdered.
Luego asesinaron a mi hermano.
And then they murdered my brother.
Pero aquí estamos echándole ganas con el apoyo de todos ustedes que quieren una justicia para ese asesino.
But here we are still fighting along with all of you who want justice for that assassin.
Y nosotros también culpamos al gobierno de los Estados Unidos en ese entonces.
And at that time we also blamed the government of the United States.
Porque si no hubiera sido el apoyo que le dio al gobierno de El Salvador.
Because if they hadn't given such support to the government of El Salvador,
no hubiera habido tantas muertes en nuestro país.
There wouldn't have been so many deaths in my country.
Porque todo el armamento, aviación, el gobierno se lo ofreció al gobierno de El Salvador.
Because all the weapons and the planes were given by the United States to the government of El Salvador.
Por eso agarró más fuerza y fue cuando fue más grande los masacres.
That's why they had so much strength and that's why the massacre became bigger.
Por eso nosotros le damos las gracias a ustedes.
That's why we thank you.
Que están aquí con nosotros apoyándolos a pesar de que no tienen pues cómo decirle, derecho lo puedo decir porque no hay algunos que no son de nuestro país. Pero están con nosotros ayudándonos.
You're here, you're helping us, you're supporting, although you are not from my country and you have no reason to be here.
Muchísimas gracias y primero Dios.
Thank you very much and God willing.
Que esos esfuerzos que ustedes hacen.
The effort that you're making.
Dios se los va a pagar porque nosotros no podemos pagarle.
God is going to honor you and pay for it because we can't.
Y primero Dios que no va a ser en vano todos los esfuerzos que ustedes están haciendo.
And we hope to God that all the effort you're making is not going to be in vain.
Muchas gracias y que Dios los bendiga.
Thank you very much.
Muchísimas gracias, Doña Dina. We now turn the mic over to Philippe Bourgois.
It's a real honor, pleasure, and emotional experience to be sharing this testimony with a fellow survivor, Dina Cabrera. I was a graduate student. I was 22 years old at the time. At Stanford University, looking for a spot to do my anthropology fieldwork. There were lots of theories at the time about why peasants would suddenly organize into revolutions. It's always been a mystery why the starving, why the poor, why the oppressed often tolerate for so long in horrendous conditions, and then all of a sudden go through a revolutionary moment. And I was frustrating. I was frustrated by the debates, and said, "There's tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of peasants right now in Central America being revolutionaries. I'll just go down there and talk to them and find this out." So I went to the refugee camps in Honduras and I started interviewing people. And the refugee camp was just 2 kilometers away from the border with Cabañas, this region in El Salvador where the military, where this particular military invasion took place. And I kept asking people, you know, what their living conditions were, how, where their well was, whether they had a thatched roof, whether they wore shoes, how steep were their fields, and so forth. And they finally got bored of what I was saying and said, "Look, there's a bunch of people that are crossing over into the what they called liberated territory, and you can just go with them and see for yourself what life is like." So I hiked in. At night, swam across the river, the Lempa River, that marks the border with El Salvador and Honduras at that spot. And I went in and asked permission from the local inhabitants to work there as an anthropologist and document the daily life in a liberated zone. This is an area where the civilian population was sympathetic to the guerrilla fighters. And the guerrilla fighters were, for the most part, the younger men and women who were healthier, had better eyesight, and could run faster. They didn't have enough guns to arm everyone, so they had a very limited number of guns. It was basically the children of the small farmers, the adolescent children and 20-something-year-old children of the small farmers who were the so-called guerrilla fighters. And so I spent 2 days, and then all of a sudden, on the night of the second day, there was the sound of helicopters, and we discovered that we were being surrounded by the Salvadoran military for the launching of a military invasion. And we referred to this as the massacre of Santa Cruz, but in fact, as Dina was explaining, it's a scorched earth invasion process. So it's really much worse. It's a territorial genocide. It's the draining of water from the fish to kill the fish, which means just killing every single human being and burning the territory, killing the livestock, burning the houses, and so forth. And the US had developed this strategy in Vietnam. This was 1981. The Vietnam lesson was in the 1970s, 60s and 70s. So the first thing that happened is we found ourselves surrounded by the Salvadoran military. And then they begin by aerial bombardment. So they were coming in with Huey helicopters made here in Seattle, the same traffic helicopters, machine gunning anything that they saw, whether it was cows or human beings, they would just machine gun it. Just machine gun into the tops of houses, machine gun at the sign of cooking fires, anything. And there were also airplanes that would come over and drop bombs on us. And then there were mortars that were being lobbed onto us. And this lasted for about 2 days. We, the civilian population, what we were hoping to do and expecting to be able to do was what had happened at an earlier invasion in March of that year that Dina was talking about where she lost her child, which was to run out as refugees into neighboring Honduras. It was just 4 kilometers away. It was an easy sprint in some sense. Well, an all-night sprint, but it would have been easy. But we couldn't because the Salvadoran and Honduran troops had lined up their military at the spot where the river was narrowest, the Lempa River. So we couldn't get across into safety. So after 48 hours of this bombardment, too many of us were wounded and we became desperate. And a decision was made to just run for it, to all of us go together and run simultaneously through one of the spots in the line of fire that was surrounding us, because we knew they couldn't kill us all at once. And that's where the massacre of Santa Cruz took place. It was dawn of the third day that we had all lined, we had all met in this one hamlet, Peñas Blancas, that Dina was telling about. And then we basically went single file with 3 meters between each person, so that if a machine gun starts spraying us, it can't kill that many people, or if a mortar falls, it can't kill that many people at once. And when we got to the line of fire, that's when all hell broke loose. And they just began grenading us, shooting at us, machine gunning us. And there happened to be a machine gun nest in the school of Santa Cruz, that we had to run right by. And it wasn't until a guerrilla fighter basically walked up and lobbed a handmade grenade until that machine gun, which killed so many people, as we were, it was a tiny little narrow path that we had to run through, that most of us were able to make it out. There were about 1,500 of us. It's hard to know the exact number, anywhere between 1,500 and 2,000 of us. At this point, running, diving into the dirt, sprinting, shimmying forward as fast as we could. And about maybe 300 to 400 people got pushed back and went running around and went back into hiding in any nook and cranny they could find back in the region that we were trying to flee out of. But about 1,500 of us made it out that night. We don't know exactly how many people were killed, but at least 60, 80 people were killed that night in that breakthrough of the line of fire. And the rest of us, the majority of us, found ourselves in a ravine hiding as dawn came up. As Dina was saying, what we were terrified about was that daylight would come, and all of a sudden the airplanes would be flying over. They would find us all together and just lob their bombs and grenades, and the helicopters would strafe us. Luckily, miraculously, they didn't find us in that little ravine. They did find a group that was above the ravine, and the helicopter was machine gunning them exactly above us, with the machine gun bullets falling down on top of us, but it didn't see us. The slides, I'm sorry. I meant to be showing this. So I had a camera with me because I was an anthropologist. Let's see. Sorry, just a second. Oh, it's up there, okay. So this is the very beginning, while we're being bombed during the first 2 days. We're hiding by a cave. This was the family that I was hiding with. And this is just a typical set of the type of population that was going to be killed purposefully and systematically by this scorched earth policy. And these are the fighters, literally. Look at the little, the gun that he's got in his back pocket. He's put on his best Sunday clothes to go out and fight and die, protecting basically his mother and sister and little brother in the cave above. And we would be huddled up there. So that was the first 2 days. As soon as the helicopters were gone, we would run down to the cooking fires and grab some food until we heard a helicopter coming or an airplane coming in the distance, or until we started to hear mortars coming again. And this was one of the bomb holes that one of the bombs dropped during those first 2 days. So that was the beginning period. At this moment, I remember vividly, there were helicopters going on, and you would hear the mortar leave the gun, about a half a mile away, and then you would wait, you would hear it go zzzz, boom, and then it would slam, and you'd say, oh, that one's far, that's good. And then you'd hear another one, it's getting closer, oh. So this is, people were getting wounded. She'd been hit by mortar there. This was the dawn, this was the morning of our first hiding place once we broke through the line of fire. So there's about 1,500 people. This is just one little section of the ravine. The ravine must have been, I don't know, half a mile long, but it was a narrow ravine. Had they seen us, they simply would have dropped grenades into that ravine and killed all of us at once. And we were just helter-skelter, exhausted, crumpled as small as we could, making as little noise as we could. This was a terrible story. Her sister had been carrying that baby. The mother was killed in the line of fire as we were running by the Escuelita de Santa Cruz, where the machine gun nest was. And the baby fell out of her mother's hands. The father, who's here, picked up the baby and carried her through. They survived, all three of them, and the sister of the mother who died survived also. And this is then, so we basically then spent another 7 to 8 days, I can't remember exactly the number of days, basically running at night and hiding during the day, because the military was scared of coming out at night. They didn't know the territory as well as the local population, so they would just sort of stay in safety. As soon as light came out, they would call in the support of the aircraft, the US-funded aircraft, and that would make them, you know, braver and able to kill us in relative impunity. And this is another one of our hiding places. Here we had found some sugar cane. We had run through a sugar cane plantation and had grabbed sugar cane and taken with us and then ate that during the day. But we basically had no food. We were starving. And then exhausted. And so this basically then passed in a jumble of running and hiding and running and hiding. And what I'll do, actually, is just read from a notebook I kept at the time, because I was a nerdy academic anthropology graduate student. So I was taking fieldwork notes through this process, partially to try to keep my sanity. And I'll just read at random one or two paragraphs. So, sorry, I gotta put my glasses on. It's morning of the fifth day of the flight. We have 12 hours of anguish ahead. If the helicopters spot us, we're dead. How can we make the time pass, huddled in the dirt and the mud of this riverbank with 1,000 other campesinos, hungry, all of us, from our five-day flight? We're frantically munching right now on sugar cane. Our oranges have all run out, because we'd also found an orange grove, and we'd grabbed oranges along the way. But none of us have had protein in a while. The little children are crying from the hunger. It's amazing how many tiny babies there are here. Two people have died of their wounds, a little boy of grenade wounds, and a woman whose mouth was blasted off. In fact, I was thankfully wrong. That woman actually survived. I just assumed she had been killed. I'll come back to this picture. That was the baby that was born. This was the grave that we were digging for her. And this is her. She actually made it through. Someone just took her into hiding in safety, and she survived through the invasion. She just didn't continue running, so we all thought she had died. But that's Mercedes, and she survived. So this was I don't remember if it was the third or the fourth night. This was a baby that was born in the middle of the night, on one of the nights where, thank God, we didn't have to flee to another spot. And she survived. You'll see a picture of her in a second. That's just some of the mortars that fell on us. This is finally, after 7 days of this, or 7 to 8 days of this flight, we finally heard that the Salvadoran troops and Honduran troops that had lined up at that narrow spot on the Lempa River that marks the border between El Salvador and Honduras had left. So the coast was clear for us to run to the refugee camps where we belonged and where we wanted to go. And as soon as we found that out, we sprinted for it. And incidentally, this is where our role as the US, as US citizens, and our role as people with access to the press becomes so important. The only reason that the Salvadoran military and the Honduran military pulled out from that narrow spot where they had set up machine guns to kill us all if we tried to cross in as refugees was because Bianca Jagger had gone to the refugee camp to do a human rights feature, and the Today Show had sent a camera crew with her. And she had heard all this shooting going on just 2-3 miles away, and she asked the camera crew to go with her. It was Richard Alpert was the cameraman. And they walked to the border, just four kilometers from the refugee camp, and the presence of a US primetime television camera saved our life, basically. And as soon as that was free, we were able to run out. But people like Dina had gotten separated from us. Dina was wounded, and in the mayhem, we don't know exactly how many, but maybe 200, 300, 400 people had gone into private spots of hiding and had gotten separated. And the army patrols were going around patrolling, looking for any group of people that had been separated to kill them, you know, whoever they found. Basically, we made it out. Most of us made it out that next day, that the healthiest and youngest and fastest runners and the least brave, like me, made it out that dawn, because I just jumped over the wounded and dying. I was just a pathetic surviving human being in some sense. That's the nature of war, is you see what it takes to survive. But most people found themselves trapped at when daylight came out, and the Salvadoran military restarted bombing them with the helicopters before they made it out. So even more people were killed right up to the last minute until they were within visibility distance of the river where the American cameras were, so that they wouldn't. And that's the camera that took our picture as we crossed. Then we made it to the refugee camp in Honduras. It was called La Virtud at the time. This camp was subsequently moved to Mesa Grande, about 10 miles further inland, into a much larger camp. And there's Dina. And you see the wound on her. She's very modest and didn't tell that first story. A bullet grazed her along the side of her, right here, you can see it. It's a miracle that she's alive. And I took this a year later when I came back and visited the camp a year later. And there's the woman whose mouth had gotten a bullet in her mouth a year later when I revisited the camp, surviving. That's the baby you saw born in that other picture. And he survived. I guess he's, a year and a half old? Or so. I guess it was a year and something that I visited later. And that's the father, that her mother was the one who was killed, and she's now a bigger child. These are other wounded people that were in the refugee camp who are still alive today, still suffering as small farmers in the middle of rural El Salvador, hobbling out to steep hills to try to eke out a living. So I'll just stop now. Maybe I'll just read one more paragraph, just at random from my fieldwork notes. Time. Okay. Let me see if I can get. If we don't get, okay, here. They're rubbing the sores of the wounded with alcohol right now all around me. They groan and their gaping holes look hopeless, oozing pus, with the paramedics searching their grimy sacks for crumbs of muddy cotton. We wash our hands in the stream that the 500 refugees above us have been defecating in, cleaning their wounds in, and washing themselves in. Yet, somehow, only two of the wounded have died. At least 30 more people with us must be wounded. We're screwed. It's the afternoon, and we just found out that the army is still in the zone. See, we were listening through the walkie-talkies that they could listen to the army, and that's when we knew when we had to run, because they could hear when the army knew where we were hiding, and it was at that point that it would give us time to sprint to a new spot. So I'll just read the very last thing. Morning of the eighth day, and it has all gone into hysteria. We're fleeing in broad daylight now, 1,000 of us, women and children, and a handful of younger men with rusty, muddy automatic weapons, running to our death. And why? Because they're hungry. I can't quite understand it. I wish it were just a nightmare, but I'm alive. I just don't want to get wounded. I hope my loved ones find out before too long when I'm dead. And then the last note is, the last entry is, oops, sorry. Dawn of the 12th day. Hooray, I'm alive, weeping with joy. Egotistically, I'm in hiding in Honduras. Egotistically, because you feel guilty for surviving, because you literally have to jump over people. You can carry someone for a while, and then you're too exhausted. You have to literally put them down and then run on and hope someone else will carry them. It's the horrible reality of war. The true heroes are all dead in that sense. And it's really only family members that have that level of heroism to die. died with his fellow family members. I'm in hiding in a Honduran hamlet, waiting for the go-ahead from the folks in the town below to see if it's safe to leave. I can't believe I'm alive and out of danger of death. How amazing. Anyhow, that was just a snippet of what our foreign policy is doing and have been doing in Vietnam before that, and then did in Central America for another 20 years after that. And thank you for caring about this.
Thank you, Philippe. That was terrific. Thank you all. These are wonderful images and powerful stories, and I'm sure you have questions and comments. We have about a little less than 20 minutes or so. So what I propose is that we take a couple of rounds of questions, so maybe two or three at a time, and we'll let the panelists respond. I see one here. Go ahead. Oh, and please wait for the microphone to get to you, because this is streaming intergalactically. So wait for just 1 second. You okay?
Thank you. Gracias. First, I want to say thank you. Thank you for being here, and thank you for your testimony, and especially you, Dina, for the courage to leave your family and to leave your country and to come here and bring your testimony to us. I think it's really important that we hear it firsthand. So thank you, thank you. 2 years ago, I had the opportunity to be at the U.S. Embassy in El Salvador. And we asked them about impunity in El Salvador. We asked them why it is that the United States continues to support impunity in El Salvador through their inaction. At that point, they told us that that's the past, the long distance past. And in order for El Salvador to move on and become a successful country, people needed to forget the past and move ahead to the future. Dina, especially you, I would like to hear what you would say to the people in the embassy. If you'd like, I can tell you what I said.
So first of all, I want to say something to Dina, so I'm going to speak in Spanish for a moment. Dina, en primer lugar, quiero agradecerle mucho por su testimonio. Usted es una persona muy valiente. Si yo tuviera tan solo una cuarta parte de todo el valor que usted tiene, estoy seguro que mi vida sería fantástica.
I want to thank you, Dina, for your courage. If I had one-fourth of the courage that you have, Dina, my life would be terrific.
Thanks to you.
Gracias. También quiero decirle algo a Philip. I am surprised by the pictures and the narrative, particularly because I've read a lot about the guindas. You know, the long flight that you described, you know that we call it guinda in Spanish. But I've never seen it documented in picture, and I think that's a very powerful narrative. And I do hope that those pictures go into an archive and that they become publicly accessible somehow. I could even think on a couple of NGOs that would be interested in using that and even create exhibits out of it.
Great.
Yeah, so thank you.
Okay, let's take the reaction and then we'll take some more questions after that.
Yo le diría a la embajada norteamericana,
I would tell the American embassy,
que tienen una deuda con los salvadoreños.
They are in debt with the Salvadorians.
Y que no le nieguen el acceso a llegar a este país.
and not to deny us access when we try to come to this country.
Porque vienen a recuperar lo perdido de que en tantos años no pudieron lograr.
And they come here to recover what they have lost, which have not been able to achieve in so many years.
De trabajar para mantener a esas familias con hambre como cuando anduvimos en la guinda.
To work in order to support the families who are hungry, as well as the time when we were in flight.
Porque es un granito de arena que los latinoamericanos vienen a poner a este país.
Because Latin America has come here to this country to contribute a grain of sand.
Algo que tal vez algunos de aquí no pueden hacer, ellos lo vienen a hacer por un sueldo más miserable todavía.
And they come here to do something that perhaps the people here don't want to do, and they do it for miserable salary.
Y hay muchos de los que no quieren al pueblo latinoamericano.
And there are many people who don't like the Latin American people.
Y aún así ellos resisten las humillaciones que les hacen en los trabajos a los salvadoreños y a todos los de los otros países.
And even so, they put up with all of the humiliations that the Salvadorians and the other refugees from other countries go through in their work.
Pero la necesidad es muy grande de nuestro país porque somos un país pobre que necesitamos que la economía también nos dé alimentación para nuestra familia.
But it's because they do it because of the great need, because our country is a very poor country and we also need the economy to be able to supply food to feed our families.
Porque no hay empleo de que pueda sostener a las familias en El Salvador.
Because there are no jobs that would allow the people in El Salvador to support their families.
Muchísimas gracias por apoyarnos a nosotros que hemos venido a El Salvador.
Thank you very much for supporting us, those of us who come from El Salvador.
Y espero responder la pregunta que tú me hiciste sobre qué contestarles a migración.
I hope I have answered the question that you put out about what I would say to the American Embassy.
Philippe, would you like to respond to the photography point?
You know, I'd love to get these pictures in as many places and as to a widest possible audience, and I can put them on Dropbox and make them available to anyone that can make it, to a wider audience.
We have time for a couple more questions. There's one question up here, another question back there. Okay, great.
Bueno, quiero agradecerles por exponer esta situación que lo impacta a uno.
I want to say, in response to the situation that one feels impacted by,
voy a hacer una pregunta para la señora Mirla Carbajal.
I am going to ask a question of Ms. Mirla Carbajal.
Sobre la Corte Suprema de Justicia de El Salvador, ¿tiene el poder suficiente y la independencia para poder procesar a los militares que
the
cometieron esos genocidios?
Court of Justice in your country has the enough power and independence in order to be able to persecute the criminals that committed all these crimes in your country?
Y quisiera también hacer una pregunta a la señora Dina Cabrera.
I would also ask a question of Dina Cabrera.
Al inicio dijo que ellas que estaban organizando para que los agricultores tuvieran tierras, pudieran labrar y también por la situación de los terratenientes que les cobraban muchísimo.
I heard that they were organizing because of the situation of the agricultural worker and because of the landowners who wanted to charge a very high percentage.
¿Ha cambiado esa situación?
Has the situation changed?
Gracias, mi nombre es Ricardo Gómez, les hablo también en español, yo soy profesor aquí y yo vengo de Colombia y la pregunta que les tengo es ¿cómo se siente estar en El Salvador ahora?
El
sitio donde está, donde los últimos dos presidentes, incluyendo el presidente actual, eran del FMLN entonces, contra quien Arena estaba peleando, hoy día no es el presidente Duarte ni Arena, todo cambió y sin embargo parece que no ha cambiado nada. ¿Cómo se siente ese cambio de régimen desde la perspectiva de ustedes?
The question was, I am Ricardo Gomez, I'm a professor here, and I'm going to greet you also in Spanish, and I would like to ask a question. I am from Colombia, and I would like to ask a question. How does it feel in El Salvador now that you are in the second presidential administration of an FMLN party holding the presidential office? How does it feel? In some ways, one would think there had been great changes, but in fact, sometimes it seems like nothing has changed.
Voy a contestar a la pregunta al compañero.
I'm going to ask the question that was raised.
Sí, gracias a la sangre derramada de tanto compañero.
Thanks to the blood that was spilled by so many of our companions.
Y a la solidaridad internacional.
And thanks to international solidarity.
A muchos pueblos solidarios del mundo entero.
From many people who show solidarity around the world.
Tenemos tierra donde trabajar.
We have the land that we can work.
Donde vivir.
We have a place to live.
Porque con las ayudas que ellos nos dieron.
But with the help we receive from them.
Cultivamos la tierra donde cosechamos maíz, frijoles.
We tilled the land and we were able to harvest corn and beans.
Y no pagamos nada.
And we don't pay anything.
Y le damos las gracias a todos los que nos han apoyado.
And we thank all of those who have supported us.
Y a esa sangre que quedó botada en esos montes.
And thanks to that blood that was spilled in those woods.
De tanto hermano que murió.
From so many brothers who died.
Que ellos en vida decían, si yo muero.
When they were alive, they would say, if I die.
Ustedes van a lograr mucho, van a tener tierra donde trabajar y donde poner sus casitas.
You're going to achieve a great deal. You're going to have a land where you can work and also where you can build your house.
Y recordamos las palabras de ellos cada momento.
And we remember the words all the time.
Como les digo, gracias a las ayudas internacionales.
As I said, thank you to the international help.
Tenemos donde trabajar y no pagamos terraje ni tenemos que darle cuentas de nada al terrateniente.
We have a place that we can work and we don't have to pay any percentage to the landowner.
También a usted, gracias también a los gobiernos que ahorita están, no hemos logrado lo que nosotros quisiéramos lograr.
Thanks to the government is also, but although we have not achieved what we would have liked to achieve.
Pero hemos logrado un poco sobre las ayudas que les dan a los estudiantes.
But at least we have achieved some things, and one of them is the help given to students.
Porque muchos padres que tienen hasta 5 o 6 hijos.
There are many parents who have 5 or 6 children.
No tenían cómo comprarle los uniformes, zapatos y útiles escolares.
Had no way to buy them the uniform, the shoes, the school supplies.
Para que ellos estudiaran y darles también siquiera un poquito de comida para que ellos fueran a estudiar a las sus escuelas.
So they could go to the schools and receive an education, and they couldn't even give them even a little bit of food so that they could eat and go to school.
Hemos logrado no lo que nosotros quisiéramos hasta ahorita lograr, pero sí con esos gobiernos que ahorita han entrado del FMLN, tenemos un poco solventado en los problemas que les he mencionado,
we have not achieved everything we wanted to achieve, but at least we have achieved some things with all those governments that have entered into the FMBM. We have been able to make some progress.
Que en el futuro vamos a lograr más porque es poco lo que se ha logrado, pero nosotros creemos que es por el que acaban de comenzar hace 10 años, ¿va a ser? Pues, entonces, y mientras que el gobierno de Arena estuvo 20 años y no ha hecho algunas cosas de que los gobiernos últimos han hecho con el pueblo.
We continue to struggle, and we know that we are going to achieve a lot more than we have so far. The previous government was there for 20 years and haven't done anything. We've only been in this struggle for 10 years, and we're going to do a lot more things.
Y algunos padres por eso están contentos porque así tienen a sus hijos estudiando y ya le tienen solventado, por ejemplo, los útiles escolares y los uniformes, como les digo, y los zapatos.
The parents are happy because now they have their children in school, they're studying, and they're able to pay for the school supplies, for the shoes, for the uniform.
Gracias.
Espero un poquito que me hayan entendido.
I hope you understood me.
Sí, bueno, la Corte Suprema de Justicia,
the Supreme Court of Justice,
no es totalmente independiente.
Is not totally independent.
Porque hace más de dos años está pendiente que resuelvan.
Because for 2 years it's been pending the resolution.
Para declarar que la ley de amnistía,
to declare that the amnesty law,
aprobada después del conflicto armado,
which has been approved after the armed conflict,
para que estos crímenes quedaran impunes,
so that these crimes would not remain in impunity,
no ha resuelto para declarar su inaplicabilidad o inconstitucionalidad.
They have not brought forth a resolution declaring it non-applicable and unconstitutional.
Lo que deja la puerta cerrada para poder acceder a la justicia.
Which closes the door of access to justice for us.
En cuanto a la pregunta si las cosas han cambiado o han mejorado en El Salvador,
Regarding the question whether things have changed or improved in El Salvador,
en el tema de la justicia y el combate a la impunidad,
and in the area of injustice and also our fight against impunity,
puedo afirmar que estos dos últimos gobiernos siguen protegiendo a los militares que cometieron las violaciones a derechos humanos.
I can tell you for sure that these two last governments continue protecting the military who committed all these violations against human rights.
Pues consideran que eso rompería la reconciliación.
Because they consider that that would be a breakup in reconciliation.
Sin importar lo que sienten las víctimas.
Without caring what the victims feel.
Ya que siguen los militares en El Salvador teniendo mucho poder.
Since the military in Salvador continue having a lot of power,
tanto económico como político.
Economic power as well as political.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Philippe, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to add something slightly positive, though, about the process in El Salvador, in the sense that these processes for struggles against impunity and for struggles for setting the historical record are always messy, as the speaker from the National Security Archives was talking about. So a space has been opened in El Salvador because the FMLN party got elected that has enabled the prosecutor's office to collect our material. So for example, now all the photographs I showed, Dina's testimony, my testimony, and the testimony of many other people have been recorded in the court records to open up a potential case in the future against Sigifredo Ochoa. And what the problem is that there's a conjuncture of forces. There's a division in terms of strategies over how fast to go with this process. And the other part that complicates things is that basically the population is more worried than anything else about getting mugged and killed on their way home from work every day because of the gang situation, which is another U.S.-created problem with the deportation of gangs from L.A. after the riot in L.A. that created the worst gang problem in Central America that it could or ever did have. So it's a complex situation in terms of how much political space there is for this to proceed. But there is a space to debate it. You don't get killed anymore for demanding an end to impunity. And there's the possibility of documenting it. And I think if we look at the case of Indonesia, for example, that now in Indonesia you see a process that's finally bringing the generals and military into some potential litigation, primarily because of international pressure through the film of Joshua Oppenheimer, The Act of Killing, and now his subsequent film, The Look of Silence. And I think that kind of potential could take place in El Salvador. The whole thing could be broken apart if there was more international pressure, if the CIA did release the documents that said, great, we've trained Ochoa, he did a great job, he applied exactly our lessons from our model villages in Vietnam, and it's working super well. If that material were to come out, that would change the balance of forces, and El Salvador would have the space, because there are a lot of people that do want to set the historical record straight. And the question is, will it happen in our lifetime?
Unfortunately, we are out of time, but let's thank our panelists.